you lose the cows, and I say goats, here, because I can only see one goat, and so I'm sure you can do it with more goats than just one. What this shows as well is something that I was talking to the director, Chris Malawi, is cows are grazers, and they tend to eat grass more than anything. Goats will eat at the next level. See the goat over here, he's going to be eating shrubs. So having these in a forest system is going to add fertility to it. It's going to give you a much better context, much better advantage to be keeping, to be farming animals on. And it's actually going to build the system rather than take away from it. The inputs needed are very small because the food is there. They're much less likely to need medication because they are existing in the way they're supposed to exist. And if you think about, I think back to the image of all the African animals. Yeah, if we're thinking about ecosystems that we, if we're operating in here, those animals are present, are naturally present in those systems. So that's what we want to think about when we are redesigning their agricultural systems. Buffalo, we can't really farm buffalo. Cows, antelope, we can't really farm them. Goats, okay? Those fulfill the similar functions, but they're much more user-friendly. So you can do it with pigs as well. They'll only have one bad day. The rest of the time they're happy, we're going to get much healthier meat out of it. And again, so you've seen chickens, pigs, goats, cows, all of those fulfill different functions. They put different kinds of manure into your soil, they churn up the soil in different ways. Pigs are more rummagers, right, foragers. So they're going to break up the soil. We also have ducks. Ducks also sort of drill through the soil. That's a different function. And all the manure that they put in is different. Rabbits, yeah. So this is one of my favorite farms anywhere. It's Mark Shepherd's farm in Wisconsin, in the USA. You can't see very well, there's no straight lines in nature. Again, everything is designed on contour. Okay. So he's got lines going everywhere, there are curves going everywhere, that's going to capture water, like we talked about earlier with Kusumada's example. But also what he's doing is farming trees. This is really agroforestry, because in forest systems, because he has decided, as have a number of other permaculturists and food forest types, that nut trees are the future, right? You can get a lot of the same nutrients from nuts that you would from grasses, but you can grow from trees. So there's a lot more production per plant, it's a perennial. You can do lots and lots of stuff underneath them. And actually we would be much healthier if we had more nut-based diets rather than heavy starch-based diets. There's a film that's just come out. I remember there's a company that talks about that, but I recommend it. It goes in depth into Mark Shepherd's farm. Yeah, so you have pigs existing under nut trees, so it's the same story again, rummaging for the nuts. And what they'll do as well is that they'll limit disease, because they're going to go around eating those pests on the grass, or chickens, or lots of other animals, and that will limit disease in your system. So again, if you're removing the necessity for expensive inputs. There are cows in the forest, so we don't need to put them on grasslands all the time. Cows exist perfectly well in these kinds of forest systems. A BBC documentary called Farm the Future, around the 90s, I believe, they observed that a lot of the cows were going to the British hedgerows and grazing on the trees. So you can. Cows will actually naturally do that. And if you do that, if you put it into the context of one of the biggest sources of deforestation in the world, which is cattle farming, particularly in the northern Brazil, the Amazon region, there's no need to do that. You should actually be using cows to restore grasslands, to restore forests. And you can just find them in the forest. So this is one of my friends, her daughter, and their farm, Marisa, in Brazil. What's wonderful about this place, apart from what they're doing here for the context of Malawi, is that it's a very, very similar climate. A lot of the plants that you'll see in the next couple of photos, you'll recognize from here. So we can really use a lot of what they're doing as examples to inform our work in Malawi. Some people might be thinking, eucalyptus, no, we don't want to plant eucalyptus. Eucalyptus is dreadful, it's an allopathic tree, it's terrible. No, eucalyptus, there are thousands of varieties of eucalyptus. It just so happens that we're using generally the wrong ones. They did a lot of research on different varieties of eucalyptus and observed what was happening around them. And they picked a variety that grows incredibly fast, that does all the things we love eucalyptus doing, but also encouraged growth around it. Okay, so if we just do our research, nature is abundant, we will find solutions. So here, in between the rows of eucalyptus trees, you have eucalyptus, banana, and citrus being grown here. And this is a really clever system that they've got growing. The citrus trees need more light at certain times of year. When they're fruiting, they need more light. Okay, so you come in, you cut the eucalyptus trees, you harvest lots of wood, it's an extra source of income. It's an alternative to extraction from the primary forest as well. Okay, but also you are letting the light in at just the right time. So then you'll get the next crop, which is the citrus trees. Bananas transpire a lot, so they keep the system cool. They have a team of 9 scientists now working on this. This is a tiny little picture, but it's being done on 300,000 hectares in Brazil, with one of the richest men in Brazil. And this is one of the, this comes back to what I was talking about, tobacco farmers and working with big business. So you can convince them to do things differently if it benefits them. And this is a very well-informed system that benefits them. This farmer is now going to make way more money because he'll have a sugar cane, which will do better because they're also using a huge amount of mulch from the trees that they make. And he has other sources of income. And now he's actually second richest farmer in Brazil, I believe. And the other two are now coming in and saying, hey, I want him. So that's exactly what I want to see. This is where, so Karin, the daughter of Masha, so Karin was the one who's working with the big farmers and the system that I showed you in the previous slide. This is her mom's land. So she started on 3 meters of sand. It's just nothing but sand, no fertility at all. And she's turned it into this. Now the way she's done it is fascinating. She started with succulents. So she used succulents, plants which retain a lot of water, particularly prickly pear. She realized that by planting succulents, she could store a huge amount of water in her land. She was planting liters and liters and liters of water in her succulents. Then what she did was prickly pear is edible, so for humans, but also edible for animals. So she was feeding a lot of the prickly pear to her animals, using the animals in her system on her land, using them to build topsoil. So they didn't have to do a lot of, obviously there's quite a lot of labor involved, but not so much plowing, but you're bringing the animals to it, feeding them the right things on the land, and building facility on the land as would happen naturally. Then, over time, mulch everything, you build food forests. Now, in this context, this is still her maize field. Okay, so in this space at the front, she grows maize, and then there's a food forest band on contour, and the next stage again is maize. Just, do you want me to explain what a food forest is, or is everyone?
Yeah, explain, please.
Okay, so food forests, like everything else that I've been showing in this latter part of the presentation, mimic nature in its diversity, but you're picking species that are useful for human beings. It doesn't mean that you're just going to plant fruit trees, you're going to plant lots and lots of trees that help to build the system. We call them sacrificial species or support species. That means trees and shrubs and crawlers and climbers that are going to fix nitrogen or help to mineralize the soil, etc. So you're mimicking really the succession of establishing, of how a natural forest establishes itself, but you're picking species that are more user friendly, human friendly. As we saw with the jungle photograph, you're working on every layer. Right? We talk about seven layers in the food forest, actually more than that, really. But the root layer, crawling plants, climbing plants, the different types of trees, shrubs, vicious layer. Every layer has its function. So using that succession to create a very resilient system and a very productive system. It's a very long definition of food forest. So this is some of my work in Rinpoche, starting at the household level. We talk about home gardens a lot in Rinpoche. We really found that there's so much sunlight in this part of the world that even in the home garden you want to be creating a food forest, because you want to create some shade. And when we think about farming in temperate regions, we don't think of shade as a problem because we need to grow things underneath. Here, the shade cools it down a little bit. Mangochi in particular is incredibly hot, so you want to cool down the system. So much going on. Out of shot, there are eggplants and peppers and tomatoes growing over there. A coconut tree, air potato, which is fantastic. This vine is an air potato. It's a that grows on vines, on trees, so that gives you loads of space against stacking in the system. Bio tree, moringa tree, all sorts. Coco yam growing, lemongrass, ginger, all sorts of things. And this isn't designed to feed the village. This is designed to feed that household. And also to give them, to supplement their income. They sold ginger, there's a lodge in the village, they sold ginger to the lodges. They sell chili peppers in the village, they sell passion fruit in the village, they sell some of whenever they need to, they sell within the village market. Around the back of this house, this is actually just the kitchen, around the back of the kitchen is a little chicken yard, so the manure from that yard is used in the garden, and anything that's sort of not really edible anymore is moved back to the chickens. But in the chicken yard, you have loads and loads of fruit trees growing, so the chickens exist in a little mini forest at the back. Very small, super productive.
Whose house is that?
Sorry?
Who lives there?
It's a guy called Simon Makonokaya. He's just a village dude. He was a fisherman before I met him. And that actually, talking about WESM national parks, it gives people an alternative. Fishermen are doing quite a lot of damage in the lake. It's not necessarily the small-time fishermen that are, but if you can remove some fishermen and give them from always fishing and give them a different option for income but also for their food, then that's fantastic. And it took a lot of work to do this. You can see the soil around the bed, sand. So to get this kind of fertility out of the soil, it took a lot of work. But now it just gets better and better, and he adds to it all the time, and he's really happy because he gets to show it to people and be the one to copy it. And yeah, it's a happy story. This is a Kusumana, this is the kind of abundance that you're looking for in that kind of zone one, we call it, close to your house. Most of these are annuals, but there are perennials as well. You won't have problems with nutrition if this is what the garden looks like. This is so we work on that small scale to start with. We also work on the next stage, which is the food forest stage. We pick really dry, marginal land, partly because I wanted to challenge. but also because we didn't want to start on people's MySpace. People were very, very dependent on their MySpace, so it was a little bit scary for us to be doing that in this area. So we started in the kitchen gardens, and then we graduated to marginal land surrounding the village. The lake is over here. You can't really see, but there is a river that runs, so we had all year round access to water here, which is very good. What we've done here, I mentioned it a little bit with the first photograph of this mother, but water catchment from contour. Okay, so these are swales. The soil here is hard enough to hold water. It's not as sandy as in the village. So the water that comes down the hill that's just here stops in the swales. The swale is just a ditch on contour, basically. Okay. So the water comes into the swale, stands, and sinks. We also then mulch these so there's less evaporation, and we plant other bananas and cocoa. This is just after a couple of months, it's starting to change. The rains have come, you can see the grasses, systems starting to grow. Unfortunately, I do have photos of what it looks like now, but I couldn't find them for this talk. It's stunning, believe me. I have some close-ups of some of the beds, and this is what most of it now looks like most of the year. Okay, because we have access to water. Of course, if you don't have access to water, you have to design for drought tolerance. In this case, we do have access to water, and here it looks kind of like a green chaos. But you have sweet potato, beans, different types of beans. You have watermelon growing, and loads of watermelon. You have moringa growing out of it. The moringa are growing so fast because the water table's quite high, so they get to the water table and boom, they just take off. Char, flowers, cosmos, they help attract pollinators and whatnot. Sunflowers, we had quite a lot of maize here, just massive diversity. And again, with the fruit forest in the village context, what we're trying to do is create banks of micronutrients. So it's the nutrition aspect that you're trying to target, not so much the big production of staple crops. That's me. Working with one of my favorite people in this country, Mr. Brigadi, who's one of the chiefs in Choya Village. So he's the chief of the royalty of Choya Village. And he came to me asking in Kasanga saying, oh my god, this is amazing, come and do this in my village. I really need to show this to people in our village. This is above Nagochi, so it's higher up, it's in the hills. We work in a slightly different context, but in the same district. And what we started by doing was designing a fruit forest on roughly an acre, a little more than an acre, in front of his house. And we dug the swales at the top to catch water. We started quite late because he came to us quite late, but we thought, wow, we can get it done. So we did. We have swales going down through the fruit forest. People have more questions about swales afterwards, like technical questions. Please do ask. Dark loads now, so I can answer them. So the point there is to catch all the water that's coming off the mountain and trap it in the system. This is what it looked like just a few weeks later. So we planted it heavily with all sorts of things. We're kind of trying to stack on a smaller scale. So if you think of this as a mini forest, buckwheat at the top is flowering, attracting lots of bees and other plants. What it does is it sort of mines for minerals, making them available to other plants. We have pumpkin crawling along the ground that shades the soil out, protects the soil, enables it to the moisture to stay there. We have lemongrass growing on the edges. And throughout this, and throughout the acre and a bit, every 5 meters, we have a fruit tree or we have a support species, a nitrogen fixing tree. The mango trees are all grafted, citrus trees are all grafted, they're going to stay relatively small. It's going to produce really quickly. There's spring water coming off the mountain. It's growing so fast, it's crazy. And people are coming to him now and saying, we want to do this too. Within weeks, we formed a garden club. Now we are working on the stable fields to set up agroforestry systems again. Maybe next time, I'll show you photos of that. We have on his field alone 754 metres of soils, and we're then working on 10 other stable fields within his garden club. This is Lilongwe, beautiful place. I encourage everyone to go. It's one of the best established free forests in this country. It's also the best example of passive water harvesting that I've ever seen anywhere. It's not steeper, so they have these kind of big banks for their soil. They plant up everything, there's water everywhere. There's coffee, bananas, potato growing all over the place. It's a bonanza of diversity and food production.
Lots of ducks.
lots of life. There's life everywhere and so much productivity. And by the way, everything around is dry as hell. It's horrible. And this just sort of stands there. And she's, Lisa has done quite a lot of work with schools and things in the area, so she is trying to, obviously, she's not just isolating herself. But it takes quite a lot of knowledge to put these things in place. But it shows what can happen when you do it right. This is still Lilongwe, so she's actually got perennial ponds up there. It's just trapping water in these little dams, I guess you could call them. The water then, when the ponds are full, the water spills out gently, never causing erosion into the soils. The whole thing is saturated with water, which means it is saturated with life. And the diversity of it means that it's incredibly resilient. If you think about a maize field, all you're producing is one, you're only producing one crop. Even if you're producing one, two, three, four crops, if one of them gets some kind of blight or disease, or if one of them is wiped out by drought, then you're really in trouble. If you have systems like this, there's so much diversity that you have loads of options as well.
Mm-hmm.
So just having diversity, there is that. It's important also, because we're kind of obsessed with yields, this annoys me a little bit, but all of these practices increase and diversify yields. Okay? I found lots of different sources, Via Campesina is one of my favorites. Feed the Future came out with something recently, and lots of independent researchers that are referenced in that document. They've proven that such practices can increase yields by 850%, that's the UN, and 400% for some independent studies done in Northern Africa. Depending on how far you start and what you did, I suppose. Increased yield takes the pressure of needing to farm more land. So now what we see a lot of the time with population growth, and you can see it really well from Lilongwe and mushroom farm looking down into the valley, is that they need to farm more and more marginal land. They go up into the mountains, into the forest, and that's a big problem. If you farm existing land well, you increase yields, you give yourself much more diversity, then you can protect wildlife and forest reserves. Is that understood? Do you have a question specifically about that? Some of the benefits of agroforestry then, in summary, creating resilience to climate change, increasing and diversifying yields, providing alternatives to extraction from and destruction of primary forests, sequestering carbon in both soil and trees, restoring water for cycles, and so much more. I've not talked about beekeeping, not really much about ducks, compost making, all of these are practices of permaculture that fit into agroforestry. For example, a human year, this is a contentious one in villages. People don't really want to use human manure because it's disgusting. I do. So in my house, we would use the human manure in trees that we prepare, we have holes that we prepare for trees. We dump it in, we dump it out into those holes, it doesn't smell, cover it up. Fantastic, breaks down. And you don't have to do any work, you don't have to bring any compost in, this all just happens. And there's no risk of disease because you're planting a tree. So, this is kind of for me a little bit. and some Arabic would say, hello, this is unrealistic, and I am forward to some ideas. I am. We need to pursue ideas, but I am also a realist. I have seen permaculture. Permaculture isn't just an idea. I've seen it work in lots of different places in the world. I've spoken to this presentation, these videos. I have done it myself. I know that this works. What is unrealistic is really we can keep doing what we're doing, the conventional, going down as a conventional path indefinitely. Questions?
Yes.
I have two.
Good.
One is because the nature of my job, I'm a consultant working with lots of different organizations, and I talk a lot with both donors and NGOs, with people who are either in charge or at the level of designing their programs and so on. And I always get the same. I talk with a lot of enthusiasm about permaculture, and then they say, "Yeah, that's all very nice." At the, you know, the household level, the subsistence, the nice garden around the farmer's house, but you can't put this to scale. And you've obviously very clearly said you can scale this up, but the question is really, with what arguments can we talk with those people to show them that it is possible? Or can you share with us some bibliography or sources that we can share with those people who are at decision-making level? And really look at design of programs, of development, and so on, so we can inject them with some alternative views and possibilities. Yeah. So that's my first question. The second one, maybe the second one is slightly is different, but it's just you mentioned knowledge. This is a lot of knowledge. We're in a country where, I mean, as you know.